Okay, could I encourage members who are leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible? The final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 11415 in the name of Emma Harper on the role of the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I call on Emma Harper to open the debate around 7 minutes. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to lead what I think is an important members' debate focusing on the role of the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly. The Assembly enhances scrutiny of each of the legislature's policy and decision-making, and it fosters positive intergovernmental relationships. And I mentioned this in last week's debate in Chamber as well. And I thank all members across Chamber who supported my motion. I welcome that the support is cross-party and that we have consensus on the role of BIPA. I also want to thank the BIPA clerks for the amazing work that they do, and Jenny Chinimbiri, right? I have to say it really slowly, and Stephen Bell from our International Relations Office. They are absolutely amazing and they support us MSPs and they coordinate our visits. And Stephen Bell provided us an excellent briefing ahead of the debate this evening. The current BIPA chairs, Brendan Smith TD and Karen Bradley MP, are excellent and they guide us through our business and events at all the plenary sessions. BIPA was originally established as the British-Irish Interparliamentary Body in 1990 to create a link between the Houses of Parliament and the Houses of the Oireachtas. The first plenary session took place in London in 1990, and in 2001, membership was then enlarged to include the Scottish Parliament, the Welsh Assembly, the Northern Ireland Assembly, the Executive Legislature of the Isle of Man, and the states of Guernsey and Jersey. The name British Irish Parliamentary Assembly was adopted to reflect the new era of relations between Britain and Ireland in 2008. And BIPA's mission is to promote cooperation between elected representatives across the UK and Ireland and BIPA members, and this in turn represents the people that we all represent. BIPA want to build on the close relationship established in recent years between politicians throughout Britain and Ireland. And, Presiding Officer, BIPA members engage in a wide range of non-legislative parliamentary activities through biannual plenary meetings and ongoing committee work. Plenaries alternate between BIPA countries and debate topical issues, committee reports, and include a question period with a senior minister from the host country. I was fortunate to meet Michael Martin when he was the Taoiseach at one of our Dublin sessions. The current four BIPA committees are the Steering Group, the European Affairs, Economic Committee, and finally Environment and Society. They meet regularly online and in person and take oral and written evidence on many specific issues. BIPA members sit in alphabetical order rather than as delegations of their respective legislatures, and national representation is only relevant for the purposes of the quorum and the tabling of certain motions and amendments. And it seems to me, Presiding Officer, that sitting next to a colleague from a different party or a party even in opposition, it actually enhances our intra-parliamentary relationships. The Parliament's regional assemblies and devolved institutions represented they all share a common tradition and a style of debate, and then these common roots are reflected in the way the Assembly operates. On the 6th of March 2023, members held an extraordinary plenary in Belfast at Stormont to mark the 25th anniversary of the signing of the Good Friday Agreement. And the Speaker of the House at Stormont, he granted the use of Stormont for the chamber and the meeting rooms for our special plenary. And former Taoiseach Bertie Ahern and Sir John Holmes, who was the principal private secretary to Tony Blair when he was Prime Minister, were directly involved with the Good Friday Agreement negotiations, and they addressed the Assembly on the significance of the historic peace agreement, and they responded to questions. Members of the Women's Coalition, Kate Fearon, Brona Hines, Dr Avila Kilmurray and Jane Morris, they followed up with a presentation and conveyed to me the significance of having the women involved in creating the peace process and promoting lasting peace. Attending the session was extremely impactful for everyone on that March the 6th day. For me, growing up in Stranraer in the late 70s, I was all too aware of the troubles when I was growing up, and that was happening just across the water, across the Irish Sea. And for me, not enough is said about the role that women play in peace negotiations in any conflict, including what was happening in Ireland and the North at that time. So, and this relates to my previous work on promoting United Nations Resolution 1325, which aims to promote the importance of women being at the forefront of peace talks. Presiding Officer, in addition to specific debates and motions, recommendations are made to lawmakers across the BIPA areas. In May, we had a plenary in Jersey, where we heard from Jersey's first woman Chief Minister, Christina Moore. She took questions from me regarding whether Jersey is considering the wellbeing economy as part of their financial policy, and she agreed that wellbeing should be considered not just GDP. Creation of good relationships has been excellent for me and my BIPA colleagues. Senator Emer Curry and Mairead Farrell TD, they both subsequently invited me to visit Leinster House, which I did last summer. I was able to attend Taoiseach Leo Varadkar's leaders' questions, and I found the whole visit extremely welcoming and enjoyable. Plenary allowed us to share experiences. We've heard that Ireland has similar challenges with GP recruitment in rural areas, and I was able to provide insight into how the unique Scottish Government-created ScotGem programme has helped to increase the GP workforce in Scottish rural areas, and maybe that's perhaps something that Ireland will be able to take forward and reflect on the work that Scottish Government has done in promoting ScotGem. The Economic Committee that I'm a member of is currently carrying out an energy inquiry, which is showing how energy policy differs in each of the legislatures. And what is becoming increasingly apparent in our inquiry is how energy policy in the UK is so disproportionately negatively impacting Scotland. This is a good place to stop for me right now, Presiding Officer. I'm conscious of the time, but what I would say in closing is that I again welcome the opportunity to lead this debate. I'm not asking the government to do anything except perhaps, which is probably a first, but BIPA has really benefited me in building intra-parliamentary relationships and in meeting with and learning from and acting on good policy to enhance the lives of the people we represent. So I look forward to this evening to hearing the contributions from other members. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Harper. We now move to the open debate. I call first Tess White, to be followed by Annabel Ewing, around 4 minutes. Ms White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The work of MSPs is wide-ranging. The press often picks up on our adversarial politics, but the work that we do to build relationships, to find consensus and increase understanding together is often overlooked. And that's why I'm grateful to Emma Harper for providing MSPs with the parliamentary time to discuss our involvement with the British-Irish Parliamentary Assembly. The last BIPA debate in the Scottish Parliament took place in 2012, so another one is long overdue, so thank you, Emma Harper. As a newly elected MSP in 2021, I jumped at the chance to participate in a different kind of parliamentary engagement. And as Emma Harper pointed out, BIPA last year provided a valued forum for parliamentarians to discuss and to develop dialogue and issues in the north of Ireland. And in particular, it offered an unrivalled opportunity to learn about the peace process and the courage and humanity to maintain it. And I was fascinated to hear about the real change makers, those who really did make a difference in the Good Friday Agreement: John Hume, Mo Molum, President Bill Clinton, Bertie Ahern, and as Emma Harper has pointed out, we met the Women's Coalition, the women who really were at the tipping point of change, and that was a tremendous privilege to meet them. But with cross-party participation from across the British Isles, BIPA has also provided a wider arena for discussion and cooperation. I particularly enjoyed meeting people and finding out what matters to them. I've learned so much about the power of talking, sharing a meal together, and debating calmly with gentleness and humility on topical issues of mutual concern. And that really shouldn't be underestimated. Emma Harper touched on the structure of BIPA this evening, where much of the day-to-day work is carried out in the four cross-party committees, which meets regularly. And yes, certainly.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Tess White, for taking an intervention. You might be coming on to this, but I know your committee that you are a member of, or that the member is a member of, is the culture one, and you just completed a Scots language, Indigenous language report, which is really important for me, so that's something that I welcome. So I'd be interested in your comments about that.
Through the chair, and Tess White.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. If I'm allowed, Presiding Officer, to say thank you, my Bonnie Quine. So to Emma Harper. So yes, it was tremendously rich, and I will be coming on to that. So the recent report published in May 2023 focused, as Emma Harper said, on Indigenous languages. And for me, with a love of language that started from university, when I did actually do a special project on Scots and Scottish languages. So I have a love of language, and I was delighted to work on this topic, and we did have professors in Doric and from all over Scotland also contributing to that debate, and it was tremendously rich. And language can sometimes, as we know, be co-opted for the wrong reasons, but as the report concluded, and I quote, BIPA is well placed to continue to monitor the health of Indigenous minority languages. Therein lies the beauty of BIPA. It transcends the political and finds common purpose among those with opposing views. It's a rich environment for learning and builds bridges with other legislators. And it's important that we do that and not exist in our silos. So I look forward to my continued participation and my committee's next meeting in February. And I deeply thank those, including our clerks who to support us so well. And I thank those that support the work of BIPA across the British Isles. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms White. I now call Annabel Ewing to be followed by Polly McNeill, around 4 minutes. Ms Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is indeed a great pleasure to have been called to speak in this debate on the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly. And I congratulate my colleague Emma Harper on securing this member's debate this evening. And I too would like at the outset to put on the record my thanks to our fantastic IRO team here in this Parliament, and also the excellent BIPA clerks, and indeed all the staff who ensure that our work continues apace and very effectively, I have to say. In fact, it is an honour for me to speak in this debate in my capacity as Deputy Presiding Officer, something I don't tend to do very often, as you know, Presiding Officer, but I head up in that role the Scottish Parliament delegation to the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly, and I am pleased to see that in addition to Emma Harper and Tess White, we have the other members of the delegation in the chamber this evening, Ross Greer and Pauline McNeill, and I know that they will be keen to make their own contributions. I note too that one of our associate members of the delegation, Paul O'Kane, is also seeking to participate in tonight's debate, and that would be also along with, and very appropriately, I think, the convener of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee, Claire Adamson. In fact, the pre-runner to the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly was called the British Irish Interparliamentary Body, which met for the first time in London in 1990. And I would just like to take this opportunity, if I may, Presiding Officer, to commend for the record the involvement of my late sister-in-law, Margaret Ewing, MP and also MSP in this Parliament. And Margaret Ewing participated in that forum, and I know that the early work that they did at that time and in the context of the time of the day and where we were with what was going on the island of Ireland, the work was very significant. And I think it was very important to her personally, because I know that she placed a great deal in terms of the importance of interparliamentary cooperation. But the modern-day British Irish Parliamentary Assembly has developed, of course, further to the Good Friday Belfast Agreement and the subsequent positive developments we have witnessed over the years on the island of Ireland. And at its heart, BIPA provides an important opportunity for dialogue with politicians from across these isles on issues, of course, anent the island of Ireland, which remain very much on the political agenda. But also the issues covered are wider, much wider, and represent issues of common interest to people across these isles. And this can be seen in recent BEPA plenaries, where there has been a focus, for example, on energy policy, on post-Brexit trade, minority languages, cross-border cooperation. And in fact, the next plenary due to be held in spring in Ireland will focus on tourism, a very important part of the economies of all the constituent members of the Assembly. As has been mentioned, the subject matter committees do a power of work in taking evidence and drawing up reports. And I note that Committee D, being the Environment and Social Committee chaired by Lord Dubs, will be holding their next meeting at the Scottish Parliament on 19th February as they continue their current inquiry on rural housing. For my part, I sit as head of the Scottish Parliament delegation on the steering committee, which meets in advance of plenary sessions and also at the start of plenary sessions. And it proposes the agenda and is looking at wider issues, including, most recently, the future development and role of BEPA itself. Presiding Officer, there's a lot of good work that is carried out by BEPA, and I firmly believe that this interparliamentary body has an important role to play, not just in promoting cooperation and progress on the island of Ireland, but also in ensuring that politicians from across the political spectrum can meet and discuss the relevant challenges and opportunities of the day. Such dialogue also takes place at sidebar meetings, which are all the more important given the impact of Brexit on the frequency of UK-Irish discussions, which have gone from near daily informal interactions in Brussels to less frequent and more formal meetings. In conclusion, I would say that the British-Irish Parliamentary Assembly plays an important role in our international discourse. Difficult decisions are facilitated and positions reached which always seek the common ground in what are very sensitive matters indeed. And if I may just flag up that the plenary session in the autumn is due, we will see what happens in terms of political events, to take place here in our Parliament. And I know that there will be a lot of interest in that meeting, and I feel confident that a very warm welcome will be extended to our guests. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Ewing. I now call Polly McNeill to be followed by Claire Adams in around 4 minutes. Ms McNeill.
Thank you. I'm very pleased to speak in Emma Harper's debate, I think the first of its kind, actually, to highlight the work of the British Parliamentary Assembly. I too would like to put on record my thanks for the support of the international relations team, but also it has been a pleasure to work with Emma, Annabel, Tess, Ross, and also Jackie Dunbar, who attended the last plenary session. As Labour's representative on this body, I can say it is a privilege to take part. I joined as an associate member after the 2016 Brexit vote and attended my first meeting in Kilkenny in the province of Leinster in the south-east region of Ireland. Brexit was not on the agenda, which mystified me, but it then became clear that you can't stop the politics taking over the agenda. And I do remember in what seemed like an intense room, I was captivated by the politics that ensued between the parties of Northern Ireland and Ireland on the impact of the Brexit agreement. And I honestly felt that I would have liked more members to have an insight into that, because it was unique and to be able to listen at that time. To me, it's almost as if the forum itself provided a platform to those parties and indeed a buffer of the parties of Northern Ireland to debate the acute consequences of such a vote and subsequently the ongoing and also the ongoing suspension of the storm in Parliament. That's how I feel when I attend. I see the politics played out. As Annabel Ewing has said, the BIPA was established in 1990 as the British Irish Parliamentary Body and soon became the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly. Its origins are in the Good Friday Agreement, and if I did not know this, I'm constantly reminded, and he reminds everyone else, that it was a consequence of the Good Friday Agreement. It was John D. Taylor, Lord Kilcunny, who was Lord Trimble's deputy and a key member of the peace talks, still a member of BIPA. I don't agree with him on a great deal. I do agree with him on this point, 2 points actually. The first is that the BIPA could play a much stronger role across the legislature of the United Kingdom and Ireland, and incidentally, he's also a very strong supporter of the Palestinian people. In 1998, the British Irish Council was established under Strand 3 of the 1998 Good Friday Agreement. The Council, as members will know, brings together ministers from Britain and Ireland and the devolved administrations. But Strand 3 stated, as well as intergovernmental links, the elected institutions of the members will be encouraged to develop an interparliamentary links, perhaps building on the British-Irish interparliamentary body, and hence we have BIPA. As other members have said, the committees which really make the forum function. I had privilege to serve in Committee D, which Lord Dubs currently chairs. An inquiry into abortion services took evidence on the impact on the women of Northern Ireland when the Republic voted for some restricted rights on abortion. And it was something I thought only such a body could really conduct, because what it did was it looked at the interactions of the different parliaments, and many women from Northern Ireland were already travelling to the UK for abortion. We got an insight into some of the horrendous conditions that they had to travel in. But what implications would there have that the Republic had voted allowing them to travel south, and what was the law and all of that? It's quite fascinating, because we had the head of medical services for the Republic giving evidence which you wouldn't have seen otherwise. BIPA is taken very seriously and has been addressed by very important speakers of both the UK government and the Irish government, Right Honourable Steve Baker, the Minister of State for Northern Ireland, Keir Starmer, Geoffrey Donaldson, leader of the DUP, John Funnikin, MP for representing Sinn Féin, current Taoiseach, and all previous Taoiseachs have addressed this important forum. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I think, as I said already, we were quite privileged, and I sometimes wish that was actually filmed and minuted, to listen to Bertie Ahern and Senator Mitchell and John Holmes, who was a civil servant at the time, give unique insights into how the Good Friday talks could have actually crumbled. Bertie Ahern spoke of going to his mother's funeral on one of the days of the talks, came back to the talks, and such as a profound act as it was seen, it's one of the acts that was seen as bringing some of the people together to make sure. He also spoke of the importance of John Major's contribution, but he said without the personality of Tony Blair, he did not believe that it could happen. Presiding Officer, it was a historic moment that I was privileged, and others have mentioned who were there to listen to. I'm really delighted we've had a chance to provide some insights to members, but let's do more to make sure that BIPA is a forum of which other members can see the work of it. And thanks again to Emma Harper for bringing the debate this evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms McNeill. I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Ross Greer. Around 4 minutes, Ms Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I want to also start with a thank you tonight, and that's to thank our delegates to BIPA, the current delegates and previous delegates from this Parliament, and indeed the likes of Margaret Ewing, as mentioned by Annabel. I think you do a tremendous job on our behalf. Sometimes we don't hear about it, though. And I do have an ask today, not of government, but of us in this Parliament, to take back that we have regular updates on the parliamentary agenda from BIPA and from other representative bodies, the likes like Clary, like the contact group for the Committee of the Regions. I sit along with Donald Cameron as my deputy from the Constitution, External Affairs and Culture Committee on the Interparliamentary Forum on behalf of the Parliaments, which is a UK body, and as a delegate to the Parliamentary Partnership Assembly in Europe, which is the meeting of Westminster and the Lords with our European colleagues now that we are no longer in Europe. And I think it's really important that we do hear these updates, because we've had examples of what good work happens at these forums. I was particularly taken with the Scots language being mentioned. I knew that would be at the heart of what Ms Harper was doing as she goes forward. But this is something that was one of the first things that the group did, was the lesser known the lesser used languages across the islands, including in the Isle of Man and, of course, the Channel Islands. And those links know no borders, they know no boundaries, because they're the shared culture that we have with people from out the United Kingdom and from the islands, but also into France, with those shared Celtic traditions and Celtic language traditions. So I think it's really important. And I know that the European Union has just been doing work on establishing and recognising cultural activity as really important, a really important heritage. So things like Uphelia and the other traditions that we have across our communities, and like Lanimers and Lanark, close to my heart. And I think these are things that, you know, that BIPA will have at its heart and will continue to look and support and preserve on our behalf. And I think that's great work. But there's also really important work. Brexit has been managed. My own committee has been focusing on the change of the relationship within these within the UK following Brexit. But we also have to recognise that those relationships have changed across the water, both the Irish Sea and into Europe as well. And these forums are so important for keeping those links going, for having that shared understanding, and for being able to develop policy to the benefit of all our communities. I'm not the only person in the room I know with Irish heritage, and I think we have to remember that at the heart of BIPA is also protecting the common travel area. Common travel area has been in existence for a long, long time, since Irish independence, and it marks the really strong, close cultural community, familial relationships we have across the Irish Sea. And I think it's really important that BIPA has that at its heart, along with preserving the agreements of the Good Friday Agreement. So again, a huge thank you to everyone that's there. I hope we can have more opportunities to hear about the work of BIPA and the work that our colleagues are doing there going forward. And I think it's been a really breath of fresh air this afternoon to hear such consensus, because after all, we don't see enough the consensual work that's done across this Parliament to develop policy and make lives better for our communities. So thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. I now call Ross Greer to be followed by Willie Coffey, around 4 minutes. Mr Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And like colleagues, I'd like to very much thank Emma Harper for giving us the opportunity to discuss the work of the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly, and to thank our clerks in the International Relations Office for the support that they've given us. I've been a member of BIPA for 8 years now, and it's by far one of the greatest privileges that I've had in this job. It's actually through being a member of BIPA that I discovered my own Irish heritage, just mentioning offhand to my gran one day where I was about to go on a trip. It was only at that point that she told the rest of us that our family had come from Sligo and Enniskillen. And it's been a huge privilege for me, because I've been able to sit in a room with, get to know and work with people who risked so much, who risked their lives to secure peace for the north of Ireland. People who'd been on the opposite sides of a war, including former combatants in that war on both sides, who now sit in that room together for these discussions. And I found it particularly significant because people my age in Northern Ireland don't remember the conflict. I was born around the same time of the Loyalist ceasefire in 1994 and the first of the IRA's ceasefires in that period leading up to the Good Friday Agreement. A friend of mine from the North likes to remind people, she says that Northern Ireland is a post-conflict society, not a post-post-conflict society. They are still living in the shadow of what came before. And the peace process is exactly that. It is a process that is ongoing, and it's a process that we all have a responsibility to contribute to, because it's still really fragile, as we've seen over the last couple of years as risks to it became apparent once again. My first BIPA meeting was immediately after the Brexit referendum vote, and there was a sense of shock around the room, even amongst those in the room who had voted Leave and not necessarily expected their side to win. But what I think it sadly revealed was a level of ignorance and complacency in Great Britain about Northern Ireland that simply shouldn't have been the case. A sense that peace had been achieved, that was something that did not need to be worried about anymore, rather than a recognition that Northern Ireland was an equal part of the UK and that peace was a process. And 8 years on, we're still trying to square the circle of the border issues there. A sea border is never going to be acceptable to unionists, and a land border is never going to be acceptable to nationalists or compatible with the Good Friday Agreement. But the collapse in the executive in Northern Ireland isn't entirely about that, and I do want to mention this. It's also about a crisis within unionism, and specifically the DUP, who campaigned for Brexit and have been unable to reconcile themselves with actually getting what they wanted at the time. But it's a bigger issue than that. The bigger issue is that young Protestants and unionists, or young people from that background, aren't voting for unionist parties in Northern Ireland in the numbers they used to because of reasons of social policy, like LGBT rights or abortion rights. Young people from the north have come and spoken to BIPA on a number of occasions about issues like climate change and education that they want to talk about with their assembly members, with their assembly, but they can't. They can talk to the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly, but they can't talk to Stormont because it doesn't function. If you combine that crisis in unionism with Sinn Féin's growth within the nationalist electorate, you get the inevitable result, which is Sinn Féin coming first in the last election. And that gets to the nub of why there isn't a Northern Irish executive at the moment. It's not entirely about Brexit. It's because one party can't reconcile itself with the fact that another party won the election. The DUP cannot reconcile themselves with the fact that there would be a Sinn Féin First Minister, even though they would be able to have the Deputy First Minister on entirely equal terms.
Emma Harper.
I know I'm thinking about time and all that. We're talking about when we were in Stormont, Stormont wasn't sitting. Do you agree that it was absolutely palpable that from the members there that they were really wholeheartedly disappointed that Stormont just still, there was no sign of getting Stormont restarted?
Ross Greer.
Thank you, and I'm grateful to Emma Harper for that intervention, because absolutely, I felt the distress of our Northern Irish colleagues that some of us in this chamber have spoken in their chamber more than they have, because BIPA was able to use it, but the Assembly itself wasn't actually sitting. Imagine how galling that would be for us. Think if this Parliament hadn't sat for years at a time, the huge amount of work that we do for the people of Scotland, the work we do on an entirely consensual cross-party basis, not happening for years, budgets not being set for years. And it's because I would urge the DUP to recognise that they're losing far more than they're gaining here, and they need to re-engage with the Assembly. They need to re-engage with the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly as well. And I should make the point, I'm speaking specifically of the DUP here, not of Northern Irish unionism as a whole. Our Ulster Unionist Party colleagues make a fantastic contribution to the Assembly. Briefly before closing, Presiding Officer, I'd like to urge the UK Government to engage more as well. Our Irish colleagues have repeatedly raised their concerns that while the Irish Government engages comprehensively with the Assembly, the British Government often does not. But I would give an honourable mention here to Steve Baker, Northern Irish Office Minister, who I agree with on almost nothing, but who makes a really sincere and heartfelt contribution to BIPA. I think it does need more senior ministers, cabinet secretaries, secretaries of state, and the Prime Minister himself to engage, though. I'd like to finish just by echoing the points that others have made about collaboration. My BIPA committee will be in Helsinki and Tallinn soon on a security inquiry. Unfortunately, I won't be able to join them. But it's a fantastic example of not just the cross-jurisdiction work taking place here, but the engagement of BIPA with our wider continent. I'd also like to mention some of the individuals I've had the privilege of meeting. Reg Empey, who was one of those who sacrificed so much for the peace process. Alf Dubs, who I had a really profoundly moving conversation with Christina McKelvey and Linda Fabiani, about an issue not directly related to BIPA, about my sister dying, and a discussion that we had on the fringes of the Assembly in a hotel reception that has actually significantly changed my views on that issue. I'm sure it will be of interest to you, Presiding Officer. And one final individual that I'd like to mention is Stefan Lewis, who was a Plaid member of the Assembly, who made a huge contribution, elected at the same time as me, but who sadly passed away at the age of 34. Stefan was a really valued colleague and somebody that we had the privilege of working with during his time on the Assembly. BIPA is essential. It's essential because it ensures that at least some members of the parliaments and assemblies on these islands know and understand each other, that those of us in Great Britain and the rest of Ireland understand the profound issues still facing the North as it makes its way through the peace process. And the value in knowing and understanding each other on a personal level, collaborating on a wide range of issues and building those relationships. I'd very much like to see that continue, Presiding Officer. Thank you for your indulgence.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Greer. I now call Willie Coffey, who joins us online, to be followed by Paul O'Kane for around 4 minutes. Mr Coffey.
Thank you. Thank you, of course, to my colleague Emma Harper for bringing the work of BIPA to the attention of the Scottish Parliament and to be able to offer a few reflections of my own. It was my pleasure to have served in the Assembly from 2011 till 2022, if memory serves me correctly, and what a privilege it was to do that. I recall my then whip, Brian Adam, asking me one day, or telling me rather, You're interested in Irish politics, aren't you? How do you fancy serving on BIPA? And that was it, basically. But what a wonderful experience it was, and I'm so grateful to Brian Adam for that. A lovely man, dearly missed. The first assembly I attended, Presiding Officer, was in Brighton in 2011. And what stage, you know, an initial experience it was for me to travel from my SNP conference in Inverness, where it was absolutely freezing, to then arrive in Brighton to see people sunbathing on the beach on more or less the same day. That geographical contrast was something that would be repeated in a political sense over the coming years of the Assembly. In my early days, though, as a member, I initially thought, what on earth was the point of this? There was hardly any real debate, just contributions on topics of mutual interest from the members, no divisions, no votes on anything, and composite motions agreed by everyone. But that was the point, to foster good relations and to search for and to get agreement amongst members who were diametrically opposed to one another in their normal political settings. A rare achievement, but thank goodness for it. I saw members from the unionist and nationalist traditions in Ireland coming together regularly in genuine dialogue with a very real spirit of friendship and cooperation, aided to some degree by the wonderful social side of the Assembly too, it has to be said. But that success was epitomised for me, Presiding Officer, in a moment in 2012 in Dublin, in Doyle Erin, when I managed to coax two colleague members, John McAllister, MLA, and Noel Coonan, TD, to pose together under a portrait of Michael Collins, with the warmest of handshakes and who had the highest regard for one another, unionist and nationalist hand in hand. Where else and in what setting could this possibly have been achieved? For me, that's what BIPA has done and what it must remain all about. Those early days since its establishment in 1990 were probably clouded with a little bit of suspicion and whether one agenda could outflank the other. But to their eternal credit, the founding members put in place such a powerful arrangement that succeeded and has endured for all of these past 34 years. If I have one request, Presiding Officer, it would be this, and in the true spirit of BIPA, not to be too critical, but to respectfully ask that the British Prime Minister take an interest and attend BIPA. The Irish Prime Ministers, or Taoiseach, always found the time to attend, and it was greatly appreciated by all the members. Over the years, I recall standout contributions from Lord Alf Dubs, Lord Bew, Frankie Fian, Patrick O'Donovan, and not forgetting Pat the Cope Gallagher. Sometimes contrasting, of course, but always taking us forward and not backwards. Very sadly, Presiding Officer, in preparation for the debate tonight, I learned about the death of a dear friend, Senator Paul Coughlin, who passed away during the summer and who served in BIPA for many years and was a great support to me too. Paul Coughlin was what this Assembly was all about, bringing people together across the political divides. If it can be done, let's do it together, was his watchword. On that fitting note, Presiding Officer, can I thank Emma Harper once again for bringing BIPA into this chamber and to wish the Assembly and all of its members every success in the future in continuing to find the common ground for the peace, reconciliation and prosperity that we all seek. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Coffey. I now call Paul O'Kane, final speaker in the open debate. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm happy to have the opportunity to speak on this important matter. Guru Mahagot Kan Kormla, Ta Ahas Orm Jish, Ave Agum Lok Ar Nhur Tawit Cho. I felt it appropriate to begin my contribution in both English and Irish this evening, and I'm sure that the official report will correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that is perhaps the first use of the Irish language in a debate in this place. I say debate because I'm very conscious of the speech of Anuktan Roy Naheran, Michael D. Higgins, in 2016, and I wouldn't want to claim to be the first when such an august speaker did use Irish in this chamber. But as someone who shares both British and Irish citizenship, I wanted to use Cúpla Focal in recognition of the values of the institution we debate this evening. And those values are cooperation, building relationships, and building respect and understanding. Cooperation across our islands, relationships of family, of politics, of business, and respect for our shared heritage and our commonality, but also understanding of our differing traditions. Through the power of dialogue, debate and agreement, we can find solutions to common problems for the people that we represent across these islands. And it is a pleasure to follow many fine speeches in that regard this evening, and I pay tribute in particular to Emma Harper for bringing this motion to the Chamber, and indeed pay tribute to all those members of the British Irish Parliamentary Assembly, and indeed associate members, declare an interest, of course, but also for all the staff and all those who helped to make the work of the Assembly work so well, and have done so in the Scottish Parliament for the past 25 years almost, indeed since the beginning of the Parliament. I want to use my time this evening to focus on the vital work of the institution in securing and sustaining peace in Northern Ireland. We are now 25 years on from the Good Friday Agreement, and I was proud to have led commemorations of that historic moment in this Parliament last year with the support of the Irish Consul, Mr Gerry O'Donovan, the John Smith Centre at the University of Glasgow and the John and Pat Hume Foundation. And it was wonderful to hear mention of the Women's Coalition, because we had Monica McWilliams here in the Parliament, a founding member of that coalition, to speak very passionately about her work. But it is John Hume who I want to focus my contribution on this evening, because without his vision, his total commitment to dialogue and his forbearance, there would be no peace in Northern Ireland, and there would be no British-Irish Parliamentary Assembly as we know it. Because, as we've already heard this evening, the peace process did not begin and end on Good Friday 1998. It was a long journey where windows of light let chinks into the darkness along the way, until finally the door of agreement was reached and opened. The Anglo-Irish Agreement of 1985, the establishment of the British-Irish Interparliamentary Body in 1990, the Downing Street Declaration in 1993, and so on, all those moments crucial on the journey to 1998, and all inspired by the architecture of John Hume. Because in 1980, John Hume met with Humphrey Atkins, who was the then Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, accompanied by his SDLP colleagues, Austin Curry and Hugh Logue, who I declare an interest as my father's cousin, and told him that there were three important elements in any political talks: relationships between the people of Northern Ireland, relationships between the people of the north and south of the island of Ireland, and relations between Britain and Ireland. And those would become the defining three strands of the Good Friday Agreement. And John Hume envisaged that new bodies would help to foster the conditions for a lasting settlement and an enduring peace. And, Presiding Officer, it's clear to me that BIPA embodies those three strands: supporting dialogue between the parties and people in Northern Ireland, supporting dialogue north and south on the island of Ireland, supporting dialogue east and west between these islands. And so the work that colleagues do today is vital in continuing the ongoing business of building better futures for us all. Even as we face difficult challenges, which I think we've heard about already tonight, it's clear that BIPA is needed more than ever. Domestic and international challenges, and as our colleagues in the Northern Ireland Assembly have not sat for 2 years and the institutions of the Good Friday Agreement are threatened, it is clear that we must continue to do all we can to bring people together. We must protect what has been built. We must offer that east-west hand of friendship, because it matters to so many of us in the diaspora here in Scotland and beyond. And I will leave the Chamber this evening with the words of John Hume, who said, "When people are divided, the only solution is agreement." So long may the British-Irish Parliamentary Assembly be a forum for the solution found in dialogue, respect and agreement. Thank you. Guru Mahagot.
Thank you, Mr O'Kane. I now call Christina McKelvey to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I warmly welcome the debate and congratulate my friend Emma Harper, MSP, on having secured it, and I'm really grateful to colleagues who have contributed. I have noted a number of excellent, interesting points, and will do my best to comment on all of them if I can. I think the starting point is that the Scottish Government welcomes both increased contact with international partners and increased collaboration between this Parliament and other parliaments. The British-Irish Parliamentary Assembly is a great example of both of these. And my own experience of BIPA was attending one of the meetings in Sligo, actually, where Ross Green and I spoke about both our families' connections to Sligo when we were there. But I was invited over as a Scottish Government Minister for Equalities to talk about women, 100 years since women had got the vote. And it was a cracking few days. Some of the older men didn't quite agree with the younger women in the room about how we should move forward, but we had those disagreements, we had those conversations, and we came to a common understanding. And I think that's one of the key messages from today's debate. Presiding Officer, our international links... On our international links, we are determined to remain outward-facing as a government, and I know that, that we do as a parliament, because we do believe that is the best answer to challenges. And the best answer is to never retreat from those challenges, not to, cuddle into our shell or hunker down or not face up to things that are really tough, but always to work in partnership to seek those resolutions. And this is all the more important in the current circumstances that we face, not only the disastrous consequences of Brexit, but the very real global challenges of which this Parliament is only too aware. And in that context, our support for BIPA underlines our commitment to close partnership with our Irish friends, amongst others. And Ross Greer, Willie Coffey and Paul O'Kane all spoke profoundly about the value of building good relationships and BIPA's role in bringing people together from opposing sides, and I think using Paul O'Kane's words, from opposing sides, finding resolutions to common issues, the real essence of the work that BIPA does. And Annabel Youn, in her contribution, reminded us about Margaret Ewan's involvement in the early stages of all of this work. And like Margaret Ewan, who held the role of BIPA and its earlier iteration in really high regard and raised awareness and supported it as much as she could, we attach the same great importance to that relationship. The Ireland-Scotland Joint Bilateral Review, which was co-produced by Scottish and Irish governments, recognise how vital partnership working is across diplomacy, the economy, the diaspora, culture, research and education, and rural and island communities. And can I take this opportunity publicly to pay my personal tribute to the Irish Consul General, Gerry O'Donovan. Everywhere I go, he is there. And that tells you something about how engaged he is with every aspect of Scottish life and how we can collaborate on that. In July 2023, Ireland's Taoiseach Micheál Martin and Scotland's Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, External Affairs and Culture, Angus Robertson, met to review the progress and implementation of that review. They noted considerable progress, particularly on business and economic links, cultural collaborations, joint research projects and shared policy engagement on, for example, the resettlement of Ukrainian refugees, renewable energy and health. And we've heard some of the examples of the committee work that BIPA do in these areas too. And as a committed parliamentarian, I also strongly value inter-parliamentary engagement. There's nothing better than getting together with people from other parts of the world who are politicians, who are striving for the same issues that you're striving for, but maybe have a different way of looking at it, or a different way of thinking about it, or a different way of actually securing and a resolution to it. It is important that good working relationships are built to ensure learning can be shared and how we best represent the interests of those impacted by the decisions taken by all of our parliaments. And I really look forward, hopefully, as Annabel Youn said, to catching up with my dear friend Lord Alf Dubs, who has been a dear friend for many years. When he visits this place, I don't get to talk to him enough. And when you do get to talk to him, you have the much so many wonderful experiences of his lifelong commitment to democracy. For example, in the Oireachtas Joint Committee on Autism, they visited Scotland last year to meet with counterparts to learn more about Scotland's approach in providing services for young people and children with autism. So again, sharing that work that we all do. And Emma Harper, Tess White and Annabel Ewing spoke about the other committees, housing, languages and all of that work too. And I think that our collaboration on health and social care is a key part of our ongoing relationship working with Ireland. So if there's members here who are on that committee, please, let's talk about the work that you're doing and the work that we are doing with that as well. And the same with languages. Language is such a key part of a nation's culture or a community of interest culture. And whether it's English, Scots, Gaelic, Welsh, or I think it's Gerie, which is the language of Jersey. BIPA really helps to raise the dialogue around about those languages and how important they are. And I know that the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs and Culture Committee recently visited Belfast and Dublin to meet with parliamentarians regarding its ongoing work on the national outcomes, and I'm going out soon to Dublin to talk about our cultural links when I'm out there too. The Scottish Government has also been pleased to observe the important work of the Parliamentary Partnership Assembly, which has established the UK-EU Trade and Cooperation Agreement. Difficult ground, I know, but it's necessary in order to move forward post-Brexit. And BIPA fits really well in the model where it creates those circumstances in which we can all meet and talk. Its contribution to enhancing parliamentary connections between Scotland and Ireland is explicitly recognised in the bilateral review and acknowledged by those who participate in it. And I'm sure Paula McNeill's call for stronger inter-parliamentary dialogue and doing more has been heard. I think all the members here heard, and they should take that forward. And I too would appreciate the updates called for by Claire Adamson and agree the need to nurture those changing relationships. One key aspect that all members, I think, raised in the debate today was around about the foundation of this work, the Good Friday Agreement, the Good Friday anniversary event that was held a few years ago, and the role of women in the peace process. I don't think the Mammies of Ireland have ever had the recognition that they should have had for the peace negotiations that they were involved in, and maybe something moving forward is taking that into account. Ross Greer mentioned about living in the shadow of what went before and creating some light within that, and Paul O'Kane again talked about the relationships, and I'd like to reassure my friend Emma Harper that 1325 fellows that we currently fund in Scotland around about women in the peace process. I met with them last week, the latest cohort, new cohort coming in March. And I think that's really important to do that. And just one point on languages, just so that I can be in the same calibre as the people sitting here. I'm sure the report from the committee that Tess White mentioned was bross grieving indeed. I get a cheer from Emma Harper on. But, Presiding Officer, to sum up, I think this has been a great debate. There's been one key feature of the successful parliamentary work that binds us all together, and that's building those relationships. I think it's vital that we work together, and I'm really pleased to have such a respectful and constructive approach as our experiences of BIPA, and we should take maybe some lessons from it. But we are marking that here today, and I pay tribute to the Scottish members and associates for their work, and thank Emma Harper again for bringing forward this debate. And we'd be delighted to have an update on the work that BIPA is doing moving forward. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.